Yorkey. I'm the librettist and lyricist of a show called Next to Normal, which is currently playing at the Booth Theater in New York City. And it's going to be my great privilege today to meet and interview Lee Adams, who has been a hero of mine since I was small. Well, I was never small, but since I was very young. Grade when I first encountered a show called Bye Bye Birdie, and I worked on the crew for a summer production with teenagers, and in that 3 weeks I memorized every word and note of the entire show. And if you had ever told me that I would be running a show a block and a half away from Bye Bye Birdie, I would have laughed at you. But here we are. Lee Adams was one of the first Broadway lyricists of the modern era. His first shows were in the 60s and in the 70s, and he's one of those writers who was able to take the really sort of classic songcraft of the early age and the really kind of character-driven language of the modern age and do them both at the same time. You know, that's what it's all about. How do you write a catchy, lovable, hummable song that still expresses exactly what's on the character's mind? Lee Adams is a master of it. Okay, so here we are in beautiful Scarborough, New York. The leaves are changing, the leaf blowers are blowing, and we're gonna get to talk to Lee Adams at his beautiful house. Here we go. Lee,
hey,
hi. Thanks for having me.
My pleasure.
I'm really excited to do this.
Me too.
And here is, this is the office where the magic happens?
Well, it's office and family room. I want to show you my Hirschfeld collection.
Fantastic.
Here's Bacall and Applause. And here's Sammy Davis in Golden Boy. And here's a Broadway musical. We won't talk much about that.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, I love these.
Yeah, the Sammy Davis Jr., that's a really kind of a very almost beautiful
it is.
One.
Oh yeah, Hirschfeld was great. This is the one that started it all. Yeah, there's Van Dyke, Cheetah, Paul Lind.
I love that jaw on Dick Van Dyke.
Oh yeah. Yeah, here's Superman. And there is Bulger in All-American.
Bulger in All-American.
Better than photographs.
Better than photographs. He captures the spirit of those performers than the photographs.
It was wonderful. Back to the den.
Back to the
Back
den.
Back to the den.
I'll the questions
you.
Begin.
I'll follow you. You know where you are now.
I do. And it's a beautiful house. So I think the first question, which I've been asked myself, but I'm dying to know what your answer is what possesses someone to become a Broadway lyricist?
As an undergraduate at Ohio State, I wrote a college show, wrote the lyrics, was intrigued by the form, by the idea, and I thought it was a terrific job. It was called Howdy Stranger, set in the Klondike, a terrible show. And I wrote six lyrics. I thought they were terrific. I then came to New York to get my master's at Columbia in journalism. At the end of my first year in New York, I met Charles Strauss, who was an accompanist who wanted to be a composer. I was a journalist who played with lyrics. Mm-hmm. Friends said you should meet each other, and so I brought Howdy Stranger to Charles's apartment. Very proud. Put it on the piano. Here's my work. Well, he sight-read my songs, which is pretty impressive for me. And he finished. I was waiting to be clapped on the back.
Waiting for the accolades and the awe.
I said, well, what do you think, Charles? He said, well, this one. And he went through the songs one by one, pointing out my bad prosody, clumsy work. This rhyme doesn't really work. This song doesn't come to an ending. And he decimated the score. I was furious, humiliated, angry, grabbed my six songs and went back to my basement apartment. And in the middle of the night, I got up, looked at my score again. I thought, he's right. It isn't that good. But he's so honest. This is a guy I should get to know. That was 50-some years ago.
What were the first things that you and Charles Strauss worked on once you started working?
Oh, well, we sort of began writing songs for just songs, tried to be pop songwriters, did not succeed. In the mid-50s, we went to a place called Green Mansions in the Adirondacks.
Summer, so for the younger generation who don't know the resorts in the Adirondacks or the Catskills,
right,
except for from the movie Dirty Dancing.
There were two places that people went, young New Yorkers went in the summer to meet each other, to swim, play tennis, play golf, Green Mansions of the Adirondacks and Tamiament in Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. And most of the guy, a lot of the people in my generation of writers worked at one of those two places. Michael Stewart, Charles and I worked in Green Mansions. Don Adams was there.
Carol Burnett was there.
And it was a wonderful way to learn the theater. We had a complete theater staff.
Wow.
Theater, costumes, sets, orchestra. We did an original review every Saturday night all summer.
So you're learning to write on deadline.
You are. We learned to write under pressure mm-hmm. for the theater at Green Mansions. We were there 3 seasons.
Wow.
And enjoyed it immensely. And some songs we later used on Broadway were written in Green Mansions.
Such as?
Put on a Happy Face. A song called Once Upon a Time.
Of course. Of course. It's funny, you know, to hear that you tried to be pop songwriters and that wasn't the direction that ended up working, mm-hmm. and yet so many of your songs have become pop standards, really.
Well, that's pleasant. apparently, our métier was to write for characters.
Mm-hmm. One of the things, you know, sort of thinking about your work and looking at it as a whole, there's a few things that stand out. And one of them is that you really, as a lyricist, bridge, you know, sort of the old school kind of Larry Hart, Cole Porter, you know, lyricists who really write these charming, very liftable songs, and the sort of new era of really writing for character. You managed to sort of to do both.
That's how we developed. Of course, when you write for the theater, your main focus is writing for that scene, for that character,
right,
for that show. You're not trying to write popular songs.
So, your first Broadway show, how did it come about?
That was in 58 or 59. A producer named Edward Padula came to us. We'd written for reviews and this and that, and said, would you guys like to write a Broadway show? You can imagine our reaction. I want to do a show about teenagers. That's all he had in mind. So we said, sure. Started working with a book writer, and then a different book writer, and then a different book writer. We landed on Michael Stewart, who we'd worked in Green Mansions with.
Mm-hmm.
Strauss has convinced me that I was the one that thought, let's do a satire on an Elvis Presley type character. Mike liked that idea. Began working. And in 18 months or so, we'd written the first draft of many drafts of what became Bye Bye Birdie.
Bye Bye Birdie has since become, obviously, you know, maybe the favorite musical of high schools and community groups, and just really theaters across the country. It's done all the time. I got to see the revival in New York, and you could see there are people who probably remember the first production, and then there were kids who knew it by heart, probably from their own production.
When you're not near us, we're blue. Oh, comrade, we love you.
But at the time, it was really sort of a very current, very spot-on satire of a relatively new phenomenon of the teen idol, rock and roll, and really teen culture wasn't but a few years old at that point.
Right. Not only that, it was a complete sleeper.
Mm-hmm.
No one had any idea what the show was about. In those days, we went out of town. We went to Philadelphia, got medium to good reviews, but we had no one in New York, in the theater community, had any conception what this was. First of all, we were all unknowns. It was Goward Champion's first show as a director.
Wow.
Dick Van Dyke was completely unknown. Cheetah Rivera was known a little bit for West Side Story.
The West Side Story.
But we were all unknowns. It was everybody's first show. We came to New York with maybe $250 advance and no chance of anything. We opened. And
what does that feel like opening night? Because you really didn't know at that point.
We had
right?
no idea.
Had no idea what you had.
We had no idea what we had. We liked the show. They liked it in Philadelphia, but this was New York.
Right.
The first review in was Brooks Atkinson in the New York Times, who demolished the show in 7 short paragraphs, the last paragraph of which is, I'll quote it to you, "It is neither fish nor fowl nor musical comedy." We were devastated. We thought this is the end.
Mike, I had no idea.
Yeah. The other 7 papers, there were 7 papers
at that time. There were more papers back then.
Yeah, 7 dailies, All the rest were raves. Television was not much, but it was good, and the word of mouth was good. And the show became a big hit, won the Tony.
Did Brooks Atkinson ever, to your knowledge, reconsider?
Brooks Atkinson retired several months later, uh-huh, by prearrangement. It was one of his last shows. And he did an interview in The New Yorker where he said, I guess it was time for me to retire. I missed that show.
He didn't get it.
He didn't get it.
Did you? I've heard that you had trouble actually even getting it on because
Scores of auditions. We played for agents, for anybody who would come and listen. One humiliating time, we played for some agency who someone said could help get the show on. And halfway through the show, all the agents got up and walked out. It was very difficult. We had some mentors, though. Goddard Lieberson, head of Columbia Records, loved the show, put in a lot of money, in those days a lot of money, and helped get the show on. Goddard was a marvelous man who invented the original cast album,
by the way. We owe him for dozens and dozens of the best cast albums.
Oh, yes, wonderful man.
20th century.
A banker from Texas was roped in and came and heard the score. He said, oh, yeah, I like that. I'll put up some money. How much you boys need? Wrote a check for $75,000. Fluky. But yes, it was very hard to get it. It took us quite a while to get the show on. And in those days, the shows now cost what? Millions of dollars?
Millions and millions.
Birdie came in for $300,000.
$300,000.
Today, that wouldn't buy the costumes.
Even so, and here's another question that's sort of close to my heart, is you sort of hit it with the first show.
Right.
Was there a little terror in terms of what do we do next?
No, it was just exhilaration, and we were in shock. I was a magazine editor at the time. We wrote Birdie. 3 months or so after the show opened, my accountant said to me, you know, you don't have to have this magazine job anymore. So I went to the boss, and I said, Mr. Nichols, I'm afraid I'll have to leave. He said, what took you so long? I love the show. It was a strange time.
Right.
One of my mentors was Joshua Logan, the great director and writer, who said, every hit show is a fluke. It's a fluke of the right people writing the right show, all writing the same show, the direction, the casting, all has to be just right.
Right.
So it's very fluky to have a hit.
It's amazing that shows ever actually happen.
Oh, yeah.
Because it takes so many people sort of pushing all in the right direction.
It's still amazing.
So on that note, let's talk about collaboration a little bit. And first of all, your closest collaboration as a lyricist is with a composer. And in your case, mostly with Charles Strauss.
Correct.
What's that collaboration been like all these years?
It's been wonderful. The trick with collaborating is you have to realize that when your collaborator criticizes this word, this line, this song, this lyric, he's not criticizing you, he's criticizing this particular piece. You can't take it personally. If you do, it's not a collaboration. It doesn't.
Then it won't last.
It won't last. That's the first step. You have to, it's all give and take. And you have to work out your own rules for this marriage. It is a marriage. Your own, Charles and I began working in various ways. Usually, as it worked out over the years, we'd prefer me to write the lyric first.
Mm.
After talking about the scene, we'd get an idea together. I'd go off and write a lyric, come back to him. He'd criticize it. I'd argue it out.
Was there arguing?
Oh, sure.
Still?
You know that. Of course. Oh, sure.
Yeah, that was a little bit of a disingenuous question.
But it's creative arguing.
It's part of the process.
Absolutely right.
Do you work fast? Do you tend to be sort of facile with lyrics? Do you have to sort of grind them out? I mean, it depends on the...
Takes me forever. I've written one lyric fast in my life. It's a song, Kids and Birdie. For some reason, it went right down. And Strauss always writes fast,
mm-hmm,
and brilliantly, as you know.
Right, absolutely.
And this is the one song he had a lot of trouble with. Funny how it works.
The next sort of collaboration is with a book writer.
I work very closely with the book writer, of course. I'm good at editing. I was an editor for years, mm-hmm, as a magazine editor. So they appreciate my editing ability. I'll let you write the dialogue into the song, which the book writer then fixes.
You touched on the art of the lead-in, which I wonder sometimes if it's lost.
It's very difficult.
It's a hard.
As you pointed out yourself, Brian, the idea of people suddenly singing on stage, singing their thoughts, is a little odd. So it has to be as seamless as possible.
Right.
You've got to seamlessly get the audience to realize that this character is singing, not just talking. So the lead-in is very important for that.
And it comes naturally out of what's happening in the scene. And
it should.
It's a song.
It should. It doesn't always.
It's interesting, you know, to hear that's a very close collaboration between the lyricist and the
Absolutely.
Book writer.
Absolutely.
Is how to make that seamless.
Absolutely.
You've worked with quite a few different book writers.
Yes.
Is it a new collaboration each time? Is it a new adjustment to each person?
Yes.
Do they adjust to you?
Well, you adjust to each other. In Applause, which is the only show that Betty Comden and Adolph Green had written the book for, where they also did not write the lyrics. So I was very nervous at first, but we got along fine. They respected my work. I loved their work. They were supportive all the way, and it was just a wonderful experience.
So I would love to, on the subject of Applause, and I know we're sort of jumping around here, but they'll edit this and make it all sort of perfect. But on the subject of Applause, something that recurred throughout your career was writing for stars. You know, writing for a star, which is a different skill than just writing a song,
yes.
Isn't it? How is it? What are the challenges?
When we originally wrote Applause, we wanted Anne Bancroft to star in it.
Really?
Yeah, and she would have been wonderful.
She would have been great.
But she did not want to work 8 times a week on Broadway.
Right.
And so we went to Bacall. Bacall had never sung on stage. Charles Strauss worked with her a lot so that her singing was acceptable. And she got pretty good. She was a wonderful professional. You know, the stars I've worked with, it's just lucky, I guess, were tremendous professionals. We went out of town with Applause to 3 cities, then came to New York, played a season and a half in New York, did a road tour, 8 months, went to London, played 6 or 8 months there, and never missed a performance.
My gosh.
Never once.
In a demanding role.
In a demanding role. Gretchen Weiler, her understudy, went crazy.
Never got to go on.
At one point, Bacall came with a tendon, something in her knee, very bad. She put an ace bandage on, went on, faked the dance, and would not get off the stage. She was
would
wonderful.
Would not relinquish
she
the stage.
She was wonderful.
That's great.
A great professional. Before every performance, a full vocal warm-up, a ballet warm-up, a great professional.
And she didn't have to be. I mean, she was a star, you know.
She had the discipline that a real star has.
And that's how you get there.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting. You really see the people who are in it for the long haul versus the people who don't know what it takes
exactly.
to sort of make it last. Another show sort of that I was dying to talk to you about is a show called Golden Boy, which is originally from the Clifford Odets play. And the Clifford Odets, let's start with that. The Clifford Odets play was about an Italian-American.
Yes.
And the musical is about an African-American.
Yes.
How did that change come about?
A producer named Hillard Elkins called Strauss and me and said, would you like to write a musical based on the Clifford Odets Golden Boy? And we said, I don't think we would. And he said, I have Sammy Davis. And we said, yes, we would. It was a brilliant idea to cast that with Sammy Davis. Sammy was at the height of his ability, his fame, and his talent. He was a magnificent talent. As you well know, Brian, sometimes if a song starts like cold out of dialogue, an oboe or something in the pit gives him his first note. Unobtrusive, but it's there.
Sure.
They did that with Sammy on one song. He got furious. I don't need that note. I know where that note is. And he did.
And the show was well received and it ran.
Well, we thought we had a Tony for sure. Until Fetter opened across the street a few weeks later. And I tell my friend Sheldon Harnick,
you couldn't have waited
the
next season?
You cheated me out of a Tony.
Yeah, that's not quite the same as being across the street from Billy Elliot, but I think I can commiserate a little bit.
Yeah.
What's interesting to me, looking at the body of work that you and Charles have put together, not only great standards and just wonderful Broadway musicals, but you consistently took on subject matter and stories that were not naturally, necessarily musical stories that were challenging, that were potentially controversial. Golden Boy. Mm.
It was a landmark show at its time because a black leading man kissing a white woman wasn't done in those days. When we went out of town to Detroit, the police insisted that our cast get escorted between the hotel and their rooms. We got lots of death threats from lots of bigots. It was a landmark show in a lot of ways.
Let's talk a little bit about the craft itself. What time of day, first of all, do you most like to write?
Early in the morning.
Early in the morning.
I get up early every day. All my life I've done that. I get a lot more done early in the morning. It's a question of sitting down and doing it, not waiting for inspiration.
Mm-hmm. Pen, pencil, paper, parchment, quill and inkwell.
A lined yellow pad and a pencil. I work slowly. I throw out a lot. And the form of a song shapes itself as you get into it.
Well, something that I think that often people don't realize about composer-lyricist teams is that a lyricist writing a lyric first determines what the shape of the song is going to be.
Correct.
The length of the musical phrases, the length of the stanzas.
Until the composer changes it.
That's right. And then you have to go back and fix everything.
Of course.
And this lyric doesn't make sense now. Well, it did when I gave it to you.
Well, lyric writing is a strange craft. First of all, it isn't poetry. You're writing song to be sung at the pace of the music.
Mm-hmm.
If you read a poem, you read it at your own pace, you go back and read it over again.
Right.
Lyrics are not poetry. They can be poetic, and sometimes are. But the craft is an immensely complicated craft because of the limitations of the human voice, because what the voice can do and can't do.
Which vowels work well and which notes.
Exactly.
And some of that is just trial and error, right?
You just have
to listen to
and
the singers.
The more you do it,
the more you know.
Yeah. Now, my wife has just appeared. Hi, sweetheart.
Hi.
You make an entrance. Very good. Very good.
Hi, Brian Yorkey.
Hi, Brian.
Wonderful
nice
to meet you.
To meet you. I loved your show.
Oh, thank you so much. Thanks for having us here. This is just a dream come true for me.
Bye.
Great. Nice to meet you. Somewhere out there, there's a 16-year-old who wants to be a lyricist who needs to know these things.
Good luck to him.
Yeah. rhyming dictionary.
I've written one clever rhyme in my life. One. I'm not a clever rhymester. In the Bridge of Birdie, take off the gloomy mask of tragedy. It's not your style. You'll look so good that you'll be glad-gedy, sighted to smile. Tragedy, glad-gedy, sighted. I'm so proud of that, and no singer has ever sung it right.
That's right. No. They don't make the rhyme land for you.
It's frustrating, but I laugh because it shows, clever is not that wonderful.
Clever doesn't mean a lot.
No, you can show off with rhymes, which usually never helps the song. There was a wonderful songwriter some years ago, a large, clever woman named Carolyn Lee, wrote a lot of wonderful songs with Cy Coleman. The best is yet to come. She had one unfortunate tendency. She would sometimes get carried away with her cleverness. She wrote a wonderful tune called Young at Heart. And in that song, there is a part that goes, and if you should survive to 105, think of all you'll derive from just being alive. And when you think about that, it doesn't make any sense at all. I say to my students, do you know anybody 105?
Right.
If you do, do they
get that much joy?
Do they derive a lot about being 105? No.
And who says derive anyway?
No. it's showing off.
Right.
You shouldn't show off in lyrics.
Right.
Lyrics should come from the character and from the scene. And if it does, it works.
And oftentimes you're forgetting who's talking.
Yeah, right.
Because you made the point that people need to follow the thought, but also the lyric for a show needs to be constructed to be spoken.
And of course, Hammerstein was the greatest, of course.
Was the master.
Oh, the master. One of my favorite things about him is how he, in one of his great lyrics for Old Man River, how he makes you wait for that first rhyme,
mm-hmm.
adding a certain tension to that song.
Old Man River, that old man River, he must know something, but don't say nothing. He just keeps rolling, he keeps on rolling along. He don't plant taters, he don't plant cotton. Them that plants them is soon forgotten.
And the first rhyme comes down, forgotten and cotton.
Mm-hmm.
And for some reason, that adds great tension that you wait for that first rhyme.
He also had the ability to use non-rhymes or, you know, identities or, you know, Younger Than Springtime. It's not a very rhymed song. There's some repetitions, but there's not a lot of rhyme, and yet it totally works. And I think lesser writers try to do that, and it just comes off a little bit plain.
I learned so much from Hammerstein's work. One of the great lyrics to me is Surrey with a Fringe on Top. It is great for so many reasons, but what I use when I teach is verisimilitude. Now, I don't really know what isinglass curtains are, but I know that he knew what they were.
Right.
The wheels are yellow, the upholstery's brown, the dashboard's genuine leather. With isinglass curtains, you can roll right down in case there's a change in the weather.
For some reason, if you know what you're writing about, really know it, it comes through to the audience that it's correct, it's right.
Right.
And that's one of the great lessons of writing. I could not write Castles Rising in Spain. I've never seen Castles Rising in Spain.
Right.
But Cole Porter did, and he saw them, and it's right.
And just listening to Cole Porter, you feel more sophisticated.
Oh, well. Porter was such a marvelous songwriter. I mean, anybody who could write the great sophisticated songs he wrote and also write Don't Fence Me In.
Right.
That's a brilliant talent. I think I got interested in lyrics at Ohio State because of Kiss Me, Kate.
Really?
Which came out about that time, and I heard those lyrics, and I was just blown away.
That's amazing. The first lyrics I really noticed in my life, well, there's two. One I'll tell you in a minute, but the first lyrics I really sort of fell in love with when I was really little were Just One of Those Things.
Mm.
Because I didn't know what gossamer wings were. I must have been 5 or 6. But that phrase, a trip to the moon on gossamer wings, it was just one of those things.
But you knew that he knew what gossamer wings
were. Exactly. I knew what and even though the words themselves, not knowing exactly what they were, I got the feeling of it and expressed what he was trying to express.
The best.
The other one, one of the first, if not the first songs I knew all the words to was Those Were the Days. From All in the Fall, All in the Family theme song.
Boy, the way Glenn Miller played.
Songs that made the hit parade.
Guys like us, we had it made.
Those were the days.
All in the Family was required viewing in my house Sunday night. How did that come about, that you and Charles wrote that song?
Very funny. Norman Lear came to us and he said, I'm bringing this television show over from England. It's called Those Were the Days. And I'm going to try to get it on. It's about this bigot. And he said, I don't know if I'll ever get it on, but I'm going to try. And I need a title song. So Strauss and I said, sure, why not? I can't pay you much money, Norman said, but I can give you a piece of the publishing of the song.
Hmm.
Well, okay, why not?
That was a good choice, right?
he was a friend. Why not do it? So we wrote this song, Those Were the Days. It took him 3 or 4 years after that to get the show on the air. And finally, Norman called and he said, the show is going to be on CBS, such and such a time. It's called All in the Family. Watch it. Well, we assumed our title song was no longer going to be used.
Different title.
Yeah. But we watched it, and our song was on. We were amazed that this happened. He said, I like the song, so I left it on.
And maybe one of the best title sequences ever, because it's sort of, you know, you get Archie and Edith, you know, they could do the whole half hour, you know, screaming at each other. But because they've started with that song together, you know,
you know, that they're in love.
Didn't need no welfare state.
Everybody pulls his weight.
G-R-O-L-A-S sound great. No.
This is the lightning round.
What does that mean?
It's the super fast questions. This is a bunch of random questions that I was dying to ask you.
I got random answers ready.
Excellent. Is there a song that you heard and said, damn, I wish I'd written that?
Many.
What are a few?
Oh, 80 songs of Oscar Hammerstein's, 150 songs of Cole Porter's. The more you study these songs of these great songwriters, the more you realize how brilliant they are. You know, when I teach, and I let them in on a lot of the great pop songs of the 30s and 40s and 50s. Right. Because those pop songwriters, writing just for the charts, just a 32-bar song, were immensely talented. Their craft was wonderful. This silly song from the 1930s illustrates how deft these craftsmen were. The song is called I Found a $1 Million Baby in a 5 and 10 cent store. You know the song?
I don't know the song.
It was a lucky April shower.
It was the most convenient door. I found a $1 Million baby in a 5 and 10 cent store.
The rain continued for an hour. I hung around for 3 or 4 around the $1 Million baby in the 5 and 10 cent store. She was selling china. And when she made those eyes, I kept buying china until the crowd got wise. Incidentally, I love it, incidentally, if you should run into a shower, step inside my cottage door and meet the $1 Million baby from the 5 and 10 cent store.
That's great.
So simple,
so simple,
so concise.
AABA, 32
and
bars.
And a whole story. If you can make a picture in the listener's mind, a little snapshot in words. She was selling china, and when she made those eyes, I kept buying china.
Until the crowd got wise.
Now, that's a little funny picture.
Yeah. So here's some more random questions. At what moment in writing are you happiest?
When it's finished.
When it's finished.
But it's never finished.
Do you look at something like Bye Bye Birdie and go, I wish I had... We nailed that, or
is there
something you haven't finished?
I would have liked to rewrite some of that, but I did not, could not.
And millions of kids like me have it memorized, so you can't.
Well, I guess.
You just keep working until they tell you pencils down.
Well, you know, I like to work around the house. I like to, believe it or not, I like to do dishes. Tidy up the kitchen.
Your wife is a very lucky woman.
Well, people ask me why I do that, why I like to do that. I'll tell you why. Because writing is never finished.
Right.
If you clean up a kitchen, it gets finished.
Right.
You're done with it.
Absolutely.
Until the next time. Writing goes on and on and on.
In another sort of direction, how do you know what's going to make a musical? How do you choose a project?
Sometimes it's the challenge of making a piece a musical that doesn't have to be a musical.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Our show Superman, It's a Bird, It's a Plane, Superman, was one of those where we thought, hey, this would be fun if this sings. This is sort of unexpected.
Right.
One of the things about writing musicals is you've got to be oblique. Hammerstein and Rodgers were so good at that. It's very hard to write a love song.
Mm-hmm.
But they obliquely wrote, If I Loved You.
Mm-hmm.
They wrote, People will say
we're in love.
Yeah, right.
Right.
They didn't just say, I love you.
Right.
They came in obliquely. If the scene says, I love you, the song can't say, I love you. People go to sleep.
Right.
You've already, we know
done,
that.
And you've done all the work.
We
for
know
them.
That already.
Yeah.
Now, in Birdie, as a minor example of this, they say, sing to us, oh, wonderful one, or whatever.
Right.
and he sings, "You've got to be sincere,"
right,
which on his face,
is that the slightest bit sincere?
No, not the slightest. He's mouthing something that we know he does. He's a superficial guy. He's not sincere.
Right.
And that is an angle that we came up with that kind of informs that and makes it more than just a showy number.
There's a story that I read that I guess Charles Strauss wrote about when you were going up to collect the Tony for Bye Bye Birdie. You actually argued about how to get up onto the stage.
We didn't know. We were so young and so naive. It was in a hotel ballroom or someplace, mm-hmm. and we didn't know how to get up on the stage. We never got up there to accept it.
You never got up there to the stage at all?
As I remember.
Yeah, when they called Tom's in my name, I jumped up and I hugged my mom and I hugged Tom's wife, and I was like, can you believe it? And then like 15 seconds later, I realized, oh, I have to go up on stage. Completely forgot about that part. Details. If you were to pick one show that you're proudest of, what show would it be?
I'm very fond of Golden Boy. Mm-hmm. I think some of my best work is in Golden Boy. I'm a bug on the proper vocabulary.
Right.
And I think my favorite song of mine that I've ever written is Lorna's Here in Golden Boy. Mm-hmm. It's a character song. It's a plot song. I think her vocabulary is exactly right for this lost woman. And I'm very fond of that. Like, I think I'm very proud of that.
What's your biggest disappointment?
Our Superman show wasn't a bigger hit. Mm-hmm. I think that was a very good show that, for some reason, did not succeed very well.
One of your few.
Well.
What did we figure out? We figured that you're batting about a little over 400 on Broadway.
I've had 7 shows that got to Broadway, not counting the shows that never got to Broadway.
Right. We won't count those.
No. And I got 3 of those 7 were hits. So you said baseball statistics, I'm batting .425.
.420, which
420.
Is...
.420, pretty good.
Which is pretty good. It's better than Ted Williams, who was the greatest.
Can't complain.
How do you deal with a flop, with a failure?
How do you work 2, 3, 4 years on a show and have it open and close a week later? Naturally, you feel rotten. But how do you get over that? Well, you rationalize, you say everybody has flops. The greatest have flops. So it goes to the territory. And the other thing you do is you say, well, I won't make those mistakes again. So you make different mistakes.
Yeah, there's always new mistakes to be made.
Right.
It's a bit like a grieving process too, oh, yeah, isn't it?
Very much. Now, with Birdie, which opened recently, as you know, we got some good reviews and got some bad reviews. It's doing well, by the way, I'm happy to say. But I was sitting in my study, where were we before, 2 days after, and my wife and I were sitting there, and both feeling very, very disconsolate because of one particularly nasty review. Nasty almost to the point of vicious, I thought.
Mm-hmm.
And then I looked at my wife and I said, you know, that nasty reviewer isn't going to come here and cut down my dogwood tree.
Right.
And he's not going to come here at 5 o'clock and take my martini out of my hand.
Mm-hmm.
So he didn't like the show, but I'm still living. I'm still here.
Life goes on.
Life goes on. When my daughter Abigail was 7 years old, she fell in love with Peter Pan.
Mm-hmm.
I got her the Mary Martin record. She loved it. Then about a year later, Kathy Rigby did a Broadway production, and Abigail went to see it. I said, what did you think? Well, she said, Mary Martin sings it better, but Kathy Rigby does the aerial stuff better. She's a critic at 7 years old. Anybody can do it.
Right, right.
Not anybody can write as well as some of the critics, but anybody can criticize anything. Mm-hmm. There's no big trick to it.
Well, you're not putting anything out there.
No. And the only reason the critics have the power they have is economics.
Right.
If tickets cost $20 a piece, they would have very little power of the theater at all.
It's really about being a buyer's guide.
Sure.
More than anything else.
And now it's a marketing tool.
Mm-hmm.
If you get good reviews, you can market the show.
One of the things I'm always fascinated by with songwriters, is the story behind the song. Sort of like with a journalist, you ask, how'd you get that story? And with a songwriter, I love to ask, how'd you get that song? So I'd love to play, instead of word association, I'd love to play song association and throw a title or two at you.
Okay.
And see what comes to mind. All right. And the first one is Put on a Happy Face.
Wrote it in Green Mansions for a review, just as a little song.
Really?
And it turned up in Birdie.
And it seems like a perfect Albert kind of song.
It didn't work at first because we had it in the second act.
Really?
I forget
what was it doing in the second act?
I forget. But it wasn't working, and Dick Van Dyke was not scoring. So Marge Champion, Gower's wife, said, put that in the first act, create a scene so it fits into the show, in the plot, and get Dick off to a good start. It did, and it worked.
It's amazing. Yeah. And it seems, looking at it now, it seems like it's always been there.
Yeah.
Once Upon a Time.
Again, written in the mountains as a ballad. We put it in All American, and there it is. It's become a standard. I'm pleased with
Did
with
you
that.
Know, I mean, when you write a song like Once Upon a Time, do you know that's going to be a standard?
No,
They're
going to
be singing that one for years. That'll be in nightclub acts.
Of course not. We thought with Birdie, the most successful song would be Baby Talk to Me.
Oh, okay.
But it never happened as a pop song. You never know.
One of my favorite songs from Golden Boy, if not my favorite, is Don't Forget 127th Street. Where'd that song come from?
We wanted to show Harlem from the eyes of the people who lived there.
Mm-hmm.
Not as a happy-go-lucky place, but they're aware of the fact that they live in a rat-infested area.
Mm-hmm.
The place that white folks think we love.
Right.
Is the core, the crux of that song.
It's a very ambivalent, I guess is a good word, song.
Yes, and it's a knowing song.
Mm-hmm.
At one point, somebody, the director or somebody, wanted to cut that out of the show because who wants to see a bunch of dark people talking about 127th Street?
Wow.
And Sammy Davis said, I can make that number work. It has to be in the show.
It seems so much part of the show.
It does.
So when you look around today at people writing for theater today and recently, are there writers who you recognize as being sort of part of the same tradition you write for? Are there writers that you admire?
Yes, you.
That's the only reason I asked that question.
No, you care about the theater and you tackle difficult subjects, and it's wonder, you do wonderful stuff.
Well, thank you. I mean, that means an awful lot. It's funny. I jumped at the chance to come up and talk to you today. Because I've admired your work for so long and it's been such a part of my life.
Thank you.
And then the more I sort of really sat down and listened to Golden Boy, which I've always loved, and Bye Bye Birdie, the more I realized, you know, we're actually sort of kindred spirits because we take on, you know, you take on a subject, you're like, you know what, who's to say this can't be a musical? Yeah. You know, we'll figure out a way and we will write, you know, lyrics that make these people approachable. That's so that we can sit there in the theater and go, oh, okay, I understand who you are.
That's our job.
Yeah. It's a fun job.
It's fun and it's hard.
And it's hard.
And you know it's hard.
Yeah, it's very hard. It's very hard. If I can have a tenth of the career that you've had, I will be a very happy man.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.